maybe this offers some tiny entrance into your second open question, so we'll see where we go. And before I begin, just a brief bit of background. Part of this paper stems from a chance discovery at my home institution where I came across a box of blank slides for slide projection. I'm of the generation that has never really used a slide projector for my professional life as far as teaching. And this box of blank slides was the one that got tossed away as the technology became obsolete. So I hoarded a bunch of them and ran into a slide projector and was really fascinated by the different materialities that these various blanks projected on the wall. So we can talk about that more later, but that's sort of where this comes from. So, and also I will start with black and white imagery in the same vein as the last talk. I begin with an image of images, or at least an image of a collection. Seen from above, nestled among a paper cup and perhaps the telltale yellow of a post-it note, nearly 30 slides sit in the billow of a trash bag. A soft light illuminates the dark gray bag's bottommost creases, the white mounts of those slides nearest the pale black cup gleaming brightest. Whatever individual images possibly fixed in these transparencies are invisible. Indeed, that they hold images at all is a bit of an assumption. Perhaps the film was underexposed or otherwise damaged, and if projected, each would reveal nothing more than opaque blackness. Maybe this is why they've been tossed away in the first place. This invisibility, or at least unknowability, comes to us at a further remove, given that the slides, cup, post-it, and bag are all made from paper, carefully cut and arranged in full scale by the artist, Thomas Tilmans, and then photographed. Part of a recent series of works known as dailies, the source imagery for this series all comes from snapshots taken by Damon on his phone. These works mark a departure from his typical strategies of image making in a few ways. Damon prints the dailies using a dye transfer process rather than his standard chromogenic chemistry. They are framed rather than affixed to plexiglass, and most importantly, are drawn from daily life with neither historical reference nor explicit archival or media-based source material, as is the case with much of Damon's photography here in the image. Drawing on the recount in Florida in the US presidential election of that year, hanging chads and all that. Given this transposition, what we can see can be more specifically described. Black paper, though with a sheen to approximate a negative gloss, housed in white. The unknowability of the slides, as they would have been unavailable in the source image, shifts to the form of a simple blank, a dark slide even. Yet this inversion is to the point. Damon's process renders whatever image there might have been as a blankness, a schematic presence not unlike Alan McCollum's surrogates, their blankness marking a density like cannot breach. And yet this blankness, with simple paper and index of a paradoxically visible invisibility, announces Damon's process. These images force the viewer to notice their own looking. As he said, you look at something, and while you're looking, you see how it self-destructs in front of your very eyes. If critics have responded by calling Damon, quote, a poet of the unnoticed details of daily life, or invoking Baudelaire's definition of modernity, balancing the ephemeral, fugitive, and contingent alongside the eternal and immutable to place the dailies, then it is a particular comparison, one that asserts the, quote, appealing casualness and, quote, offhand style of the dailies that shares an affinity with Wolfgang Tilman's work that serves my purposes most precisely today. Of course, his photographers have radically different approaches. Yet whether we contrast the artifice of Damon's photograph paper structures to Tilman's in-the-flesh imagery, Tilman's presence in a social world against Damon's unpopulated and eerie images in that sense, or even their distinct, if equally precise, modes of installation, certain congruencies emerge through the dailies and beyond. Both artists fundamentally work with the space between pictures. Damon approaches this more often with a historical accent, whereas Tilman stresses a certain productive heterogeneity of subject matter in the assertion of incompleteness and the unseen inherent in each image. Both do this with paper, each stressing its materiality in different, ultimately reinforcing ways. To be fair, Tilman disagrees with a reading of his work that emphasizes an aesthetics of everydayness like the one endured in the above comparison. He said once, I don't have a bunch of beautiful tulips on my table every day of the year. Yet the materiality of his days offers consistent problems. At the most basic level, he has explained, all I do every day is work with pieces of paper. I shape colors and dyes on paper, creating objects that carry more meaning than just the context of the image on their surface. This idea is at the beginning of all my work. How does meaning take hold on a piece of paper? Tilmans stresses the material's basic everydayness, explaining, quote, "The good thing about paper is that everyone's familiar with it. Everyone has their own experience of using it. Everyone holds it in their hands every day of the week. There's no mystery about how it's made." This sense of familiarity is perhaps what I mean when I say you essentially know an image before you see it. Paper is common merchandise, he said. Alongside this commonness, and I quote again, "A sheet of paper is the medium for certain things, for ideas," end quote. How the invisibility of ideation coheres to paper and the terms of paper itself is my main concern here today. Exemplary in this regard are Tilmans' 2007 book Manual and its use of empty pages, alongside a few instances of provocative emptiness in the dailies and elsewhere in Tilmans' work. I would like to suggest that these blanknesses and the invisibilities that they thus gesture toward reduce to neither simple absences nor monochromatic colors. They are engines of reframing, signaling an attempt to strip away conventional transactional modes of perception with absence as a marker of attentive potential and worldly realization. As the title suggests, Manual may perhaps be read as a primer on Tilmans' practice, reproducing imagery made by the artist with and without the aid of the camera lens, as well as documentation and ephemera. The book stresses the interplay between photographic installations and the documentary presences of his Truth Study Center tables, a series of works begun in 2005. And these are all, everything that looks like a scan from a book is in fact a scan from a book, from this physical book. As Tilman writes in Manual's accompanying text, quote, "A way of approach involves not knowing, rejecting grand statements and embracing doubt. In my studio, as well as when setting up exhibitions, I use tables to lay out and look at pictures before they go on the wall or into a book. The pictures are loosely arranged, unfixed, held in position by their own weight. The method of laying out two-dimensional objects on a table produces clarity and allows perspective. A new text emerges through a combination of intrinsically different pieces of paper," he said. Stressing the polyphonic nature of these arrangements, Tilmans uses various sources to amplify and contrast oppositional and neighboring points of view, all in the service of fundamental questions. He asks rhetorically, "When do developments become noticeable? When is a process recognizable? Which one achieves critical mass? When does something become something? When do things become visible? What can pictures make visible?" Such questions address social issues and processes as much as formal concerns. Manual, as a book, documents and extends the debates presented in the Truth Study Centers, a task that is more systematically undertaken in the 2015 volume, What's Wrong with Redistribution, where Tilmans engages problematic claims, absolute truth, and public discourse. His strategies of juxtaposition show processes of learning via myriad sources and varied viewpoints, be it about AIDS, Bush-era militarism, astronomy, economic inequality, and at the same time build visually dynamic compositions. A formal dogma taken up in Manual and elsewhere is the false split between abstraction and figuration, acknowledging that, quote, "an abstract picture is representational because it exists as an object that represents itself. The image can't be isolated from the surface that it's on." The inclusion of numerous chemigrams from Tilman's Silver series, which are works made with controlled use of dirty chemicals and processing equipment, which comprise the first 8 spread of Manual, as well as additional monochromes from the Impossible Colors works, set the term for a materially inclusive and formally attentive approach to content. To be sure, nearly everything in Manual reproduces pieces of paper. Illustrated artworks and installation imagery, as much as internet pronouns and scratch jottings, get reanimated by their very inclusion in the work. And if meaning takes hold not only in the framings integral to each image, but also in their echoes across these pages, then this forces the question of paper and meaning anew. 5 instances of unambiguous paper blankness occur in Manual. Tilmans includes 3 images of conventionally blank pages, a piece of lined paper torn from a spiral notebook, a sheet of redlined graph paper, and the slide, or excuse me, an agenda page, its empty lines raising the question of what might have happened on this date, Saturday, April 9th, 2000. Alongside these examples is the reproduction of faded colored paper, and is part of an extended suite of installation views of the nearly monochromatic set of 48 prints that comprise the work For the Victims of Organized Religions of 2006, a single blank page, the whiteness of which nearly bleeds into the ample lines of white gallery walls defined by the grid of sea prints. Intermittent and varied, these blanknesses do not so much bookend the imagery as empty pages at the end of a text for notes might, but in their scatter offer a frame. As all of Tilman's works make clear, the artist revels, in the quote, visual pleasure found, again, quote, in the drama of a newspaper clipping the size of a beer mat. Though the aesthetic potential of differently scaled and arranged objects might be taken as a given, in instances of blankness, the emphasis falls on surface. One of Tilmans is often investigated via clothing. He says, surfaces are ambiguous. I am interested in the ambiguity of codes and surfaces and the fact that they carry content. Since the early 90s, I have been working on an ongoing group of pictures called Faltenhof, pictures of clothes as they hang to dry or lie abandoned. To me, clothes have always been a significant part of the visual world. They are a major part of our surface, a membrane between the outside world and the body. They are a sensual surface as well as a sculptural surface, and they say a lot about the organization of human life in general. End quote. Though isolated images of clothing are included in manual, the Faltenhof series itself is absent, and perhaps instances of paper blankness equally figure this membrane between self and world. Looking at more recent work further concretizes this. In 2015, as part of an exhibition at David Swerner in New York entitled PCR, Tilman showed a series of Truth Study Center tables with the title I Refuse to Be Your Enemy, comprised of blank sheets of standard-sized U.S. office paper in letter, legal, and ledger formats. So all this paper is just blank. This work was reprised in 2016 at Moyne Paley here in London, mixing A4 and 8.5x11 sort of metric and English paper sizes. Whether A4, 8.5x11, lined or gridded, our world finds form through the availabilities these blanknesses allow. And while we often see differences, similarities abound. In their stark blanknesses, these pages also stress their support. In this case, the wooden tabletops used in the Truth Study Centers. These are British-made hollow core doors, and they serve as tables for these works, concretely engaging bodily proportions transposed from the vertical to the horizontal. The door marks an architectural and thus bodily threshold, just as the paper laid atop their surfaces laid atop offers surfaces upon which the interiority may become legibly exterior, a space of the becoming visible. Tilmans carefully considers the placement of each table, as evinced by the precision of his preparatory drawings. They return me, however, to a comparison made in manual between a series of open or cropped rectangles surrounding the phrase social fabric and a bare room pictured in the 2006 work entitled Studio Light. Here, the blank space between objects defines the social, just as the empty rectangles cue the blanknesses of paper primed for content, widened further by the play of light on empty studio walls. This beam of light might well have faded the blank sheet set against the color photocopy of currency. Only by consulting Manuel's index did I learn that this play of orange was a found blankness rather than one of the silver chemigrams, but that's essential. Its fading reads abstractly, stressing the potentiality held in blank surfaces, this membrane further between mind and world. Empty pages wait to be filled, reframed, and recontextualized, cueing the constellational overlaps at the core of Tilman's imagery. In Damon's photography, that emptiness is the imagery and the mode of meaning making. Consider the early office, 1995. Based on a newspaper image documenting the destruction wrought at the Stasi headquarters in Berlin, after East German citizens stormed the building on January 16, 1990, in search of files pertaining to their lives. Far from an exact replica of the original photograph, Damon's sculptural adaptation dwells on the scattered papers and open files the people left in their wake. All these pages are blank. In one sense, this is normal. Damon constructs his paper models mostly free of embellishment, with scale and pattern standing in for text. Yet the blankness also foregrounds the uncertainty that East Germans lived with for so long, as a population never sure who might be under surveillance, and what information the government might have known. As Alexander Kluge puts it, the images frame, quote, the specters of history left behind. It looks ghostly and yet realistic. Certain dailies wear blankness a bit differently. and the sculptural rendering of the bulletin board and stray groupings of pushpins that comprise daily number 8. Demon thematizes the receptivity of surface. It takes a hard look to find evidence of the image's constructiveness. Perhaps the upper left corner of the board's wooden frame betrays the folds of paper, but that matters little. Again, a site of the becoming visible. A brown frame brackets the square of green as a site of attention that not only doubles as a non-modernist abstraction, but also holds open the very space of noticing that pin boards occupy in everyday life. The surface betrays much use. It's green parked with tiny holes, the residues of prior constellations of material. The pins in their small cluster to the right and wide leftward spread offer an allegory of awareness, ready to pierce some snatch of information and place it in a context among others, and in so doing create a link between the materiality of the world and an activated viewership. We commonly overlook the mechanisms of such noticing, grouping, and remembering, focusing instead on the particular information held rather than the space that enables the thought. And it's the pause of the emptiness itself, something we quickly look past, that Damon suggests is worth our time. Such a pin board would look right at home in Ghost, in 2003. Instead, we see an empty sheet standing in for a calendar alongside two other monochrome panels keeping photographs. So here, and then these guys. The real action, however, comes in the form of the flying scissors, pot, and lid, set in motion by an unseen spirit. And the source image here is just too good to skip, so I'll show you all that. And while scholars have acknowledged the references to spirit photography or surrealist cinema alongside the haunting afterimages that doubly characterize Damon's photographic practice, I might phrase it a bit differently. Damon carefully floated a sky blue piece of paper in the image, and it marks the specific invisibility. The sheet hovers over stacks of daily life, so here, all these stacks of paper that suggest something a bit different from this one here. But in its blank blueness, it contains the world. Not a world to be made, but one to be seen. The other streak offers a small break from the domestic work surface below, its regular framing twisted on the wind, suggesting the unformed potential it contains to solicit and embolden a different type of attention. Paper blankness comes in a range of physical formats and temporalities, each potentially expansive. I will end with a different model of blankness, rooted in writing, found in the paper collection of the American novelist Jonathan Safran Foer, who began collecting blanks in 2002. Initially sparked by the gift of a blank sheet from Isaac Bashevis Singer's archive, the writer's empty paper having been found to hold no archival value, Foer became obsessed with the slightly yellowed page. It occupied a site of pure possibility, one keyed exclusively to the author. Foer writes, quote, "The blank page contained everything Singer could have written and everyone he could have become," end quote. By a strange logic, the blank page became an infinite site unmarred by ink but also untethered to reality, the place where a specific author's perfect text might live. Foer solicited blanks from friends and writers and has since accumulated a collection that includes empty pages drawn from the pads of Susan Sontag and Paul Auster, Zadie Smith, and even Sigmund Freud. Musing on his collection, Foer explained, quote, "The ideal sheet would not necessarily be that of the greatest writer, but that which held the most potential," end quote, and wonders about a sheet of Sebald's or a page from Anne Frank's diary. Foer's papers gain weight from specific authors. They are less productively anonymous and more bound to tropes of genius than the visually centered blanks that have been my subject thus far, yet not fully. The text I've been quoting from was published in Playboy in January of 2004, and he used his allotted editorial space to fashion a different blankness. He wrote, "If I insert one blank page, when the magazine is printed, it will become more than 3 million blank pages. Stacked, these blank pages would form an empty column ahead of the Empire State Building. Laid end to end, they could cover a path from Boston to Washington, D.C. And more than that, as Playboy has a readership of close to 10 million, the mental space that these empty pages would occupy is breathtaking. One blank page, created with the ease of a single hard return, will contain the potential of each of the 10 million people who look at it. What might they draw? What might they write? What thoughts might it inspire in them? What image would they see in its depths? What image do you see?" He did this, reproducing a standard piece of blue-lined paper torn from a spiral notebook, not dissimilar to the blanks in Tilmans' manual, and under the guise of, here's my bad joke about invisibility, the Naked Page Project, as he called it, with reference to Playboy, asked readers to cut out the page and return it to the magazine. A few hundred people sent them back. And though many wrote or drew on them, the single most common return page was an empty one, just as it had been published in the magazine in the first place. To offer spaces of such invisibility, and to sit with such weaknesses, I think, might be a way of looking to the blank moments of history, and perhaps equally those of the present, with a grounding in awe they can trigger, but certainly not.